Good evening, everyone. Welcome to Observer Research Foundation. My name is Mansi Parpiani. I'm a research fellow at Observer Research Foundation, Mumbai. Today we are having a very interesting talk on caves of Mumbai by Professor Anita Rane-Kothare. Just a brief introduction about her before she begins. Dr. Anita Rane-Kothare is the head of Department of Ancient Indian Culture at St. Xavier's College. She's been teaching since 22 years, a range of subjects like archaeology, museology, art, history, heritage conservation, etc. She's also been a visiting faculty at the JJ School of Architecture. She's most known recently for the discovery she's made in 2007 while conducting research on traditional methods used for rainwater harvesting. In the caves, she discovered the 6th century Magathane caves in Mumbai. She has a very exhaustive presentation for us that's going to outline the variety of caves that the city of Mumbai has. Without much this, I will call Ms. Professor Anita. Yeah.
Foundation of Mumbai for inviting me over. Yeah, I think it all began with the conference which took place of 2-3 weeks ago. And I just spoke when somebody said over here, there is nothing to see in Mumbai. What shall we show the visitors? And I said, how can you say such things? There are such beautiful things. And this is how the whole thing began. And then they approached me and said, why don't you talk about the caves? So I said, let me tell you all about these caves. But before we go into understanding caves, you have to understand different aspects of Mumbai. And then you'll understand why caves were excavated over here. I will not say constructed. Caves are not constructed, they are excavated. They are chiseled out. So once you know the whole background, you will be able to understand these things. So let us start with the whole thing over here. Now, because you and I love Mumbai, Mumbai is known as Mumbapuri, Bombay, Mumbai, whatever you may call it. I love calling it Bombay and Mumbai, it doesn't matter to me. But it does indicate that Mumbai has a very rich tradition. So here I have taken a satellite image of Mumbai, you can see. And we are going to talk about caves which are located only in this region around. You can see this is the Gharapuri and you have over there Sopara. Okay, Sopara was an ancient port. That is the most important thing. So you have to understand that Bombay was made, or Mumbai was made of 7 islands. Plus if you add today's Bruhan Mumbai, you have Sashti. Okay, or Salset, 66 islands, plus you have Thane also. So Thane was also an important port. You have Cheul as an important port. And you have this, you can say, site. Across you have what you call as the so-called Konkan region. And Konkan, if you'll know, in ancient times was termed as Aparanta. Now, let me jump into philology for a moment. Aparanta means a adhik pranta. Pranta means a territory, a means which is aloof. And if you go to see, Konkan is, you can say, divided by the Western Ghats. And so to come down from the Deccan Plain, you have to come through trade routes. Come down to Konkan, sail across, come to Mumbai, go across, go towards Sopara, and then proceed towards different countries. And you have evidences of Suparaka Jataka, Baveru Jataka. You have Suparaka mentioned in Mahabharata. So you will see the historicity of Sopara goes right up to, you can say, 6th century BC. Even Periplus of the Erythraean Sea says this so. So now we come to this aspect. Now to come down, these Buddhists, you can say, were very smart. And they decided to, you can say, make caves all along the trade routes. And this is not an Indian tradition, or it is not an idea which Buddha said. This was already existing. He said that you can say, cut the scarp of the hill and carve a cave and stay. Pabbatem khanitva pabaram sodha petva lenam kut kamo. This is what Gautam Buddha says. That means the concept of caves was already known to him. So these are not natural caves, these are man-made caves. But the earliest caves which we know are actually, which were found, are supposed to be the Mauryan caves, that is the Lomasha Rishi cave and the Sudama cave. So in all, if you go to in India, we have about 1,200 man-made caves, of which 900 caves are located in Maharashtra, of which 150 caves are located in and around Mumbai. So you can understand how much you can say treasure we Mumbaikars really have. And it's a sad thing we don't. I mean over here, Brahmanical and Buddhist. We don't have Jain caves over here, but Brahmanical and Buddhist caves, we have about 150 of them. Of which Brahmanical caves, two of the biggest caves in the country are located near Mumbai. One is the Jogeshwari cave and second are the Elephanta or the Gharapuri caves. And the third one which you have are the Dhumar Lena at Ellora. So three such, you can say, important sites which you will have are located in the city of Mumbai. So as I was telling you all, you have the, you can say, traveler coming all the way across. Here I'm trying to show you all these places. From Elephanta, Elephanta is Gharapuri, come down across, sail towards, you can say, Sopara, make a halt in one of the caves and proceed ahead. This was a tradition and that was the reason why they had made caves. And to understand furthermore about all these things, we have to understand inscription, which I will go to a little bit later on. Okay? So here are Mumbai and its islands, just to show you all. You have the Old Women's Island, Mazagao, Sivri, Shyam, Bharat Bay. And you have different sites located over here. One more thing you have to understand is the geomorphology of that region. For example, Mumbai is known for amygdaloidal basalt. And the later part, it is towards Borivali, trachylite and rhyolite. So again, it depends upon the quality of the rock from which you can create a cave. So when you all see a cave, an architect will be able to understand many a times they have avoided certain places. We shall not go into detail over here about this. For example, if you go to Elephanta, you have, you can see a beautiful sculpture in the annex of cave number one. But unfortunately, it's slightly crooked. It's not because the Portuguese have mutilated it. It is because of a dike in the middle which flows. And you'll find that the artisans were aware of these faults. So many times they have avoided certain areas as well. So here you all have different sets of caves, I mean sites here, islands. And here you all have Elephanta. We can start from that side. And you have the three bandars, most important, Mora Bandar and the Raj Bandar. Now let me tell you all, this was also a Buddhist site. You will find that there were stupas found on top over here. Generally, we go and see only the Brahmanical caves. Last year, we had a trip organized when I took them all to see the unknown areas of Elephanta. And another tradition which we all do is I circumambulate around the whole island during low tide to make people see the old remains of, we can say, walls and things around here. So you have, you can say, the Buddhist over here monks would cross across here and go ahead. And they have found many things at Elephanta. For example, lead coins have been found. They have also found over here Prasava Devta that shows fertility cult, which I will show you all. And from here, this person would proceed. So after the fall or the decline of Buddhist period, you'll find it was taken over by the Pashupata sect. So you can see from Navashiva, Trombay. Now Trombay is an interesting place. Not many of us know that they discovered an Avalokiteshvara also over there. So it's something quite interesting. If the TIFR and the BRC allow, we should, you can say, do treks there. We'll find more things and perhaps caves also. And let me tell you all, there's a lovely lake-like tank above one of the hills of this Trombay. I don't know if you'll go by plane, you'll be able to see it, and it's a treat for us. So here I'm trying to show you all certain things. This is the map. All along the ghats over here, you have caves made by the Buddhists. And here you have Mumbai. And you have few caves like the Kondivit and the Kanheri caves, the Magathane caves. So I'm just trying to show you all the Sayadri range, just a pattern over here, the mountain range, and all these are routes on which you have these things. You have all the archaeological sites, they're reverse flowing, and you'll see that always on a top of a hillock here. And there are different sites around over here. You have Chowl, which was a port. Again, there are important caves like Mahad caves and all located here. There are Ambivali, you have Mahad, you have Lonard, which is also quite near to Mumbai. So here I've just tried to show you all that this was an ancient trade route. And with this, they could proceed to, you can say, Persian Gulf, Agni Mala, Aden, Dadi Mala, and Nilkashuv Mala. So these are places where they used to have foreign trade and right from Sopara. So Sopara was an important site. And again, you had important, you can say, ghats like the Nane Ghat. from where they could come to Kalyan, and from Kalyan they could come to Mumbai. You have the Bhor Ghat, you have the Khandala Ghat. Khandala, you have four sets of caves. You have over here Karla, Bhaja, Bedsa, and Kondane caves. And again, from here they could proceed to Daman, Basin. So you see, this was a very important trade center. I'll just try to show you all the geological formation for understanding why certain caves have faults in them. We won't go into detail about this. This will be quite boring for you all, but still. Okay, so you can see this creek view, you go across and you have Sopara over here. Now, who ruled over Mumbai? That is the most important thing. Now, Mumbai was known, at least, we have prehistoric evidences of Mumbai. At Akurli, they have found prehistoric tools also. But from the historical period, this was occupied by the Mauryans. So you had, you can say, Ashoka Maurya taking over. That is Chandragupta Maurya's time. This was already a part. But of course, they were under feudatories. So after the Mauryas, you all have the Satavahanas, who were the ones who were responsible for making the caves. Then you all have Mauryas of Konkan. These are, you can say, a sub, you can say, dynasty, the Mauryas who stayed in that area. There's a controversy that perhaps that they made Elephanta as their capital. Then you all had the Kalachuris, but this is another question mark here, because Kalachuris didn't actually rule over here, but they had feudatory rule in this area. You all had the Traikutukas, who ruled in about 5th century AD, 3rd to 5th century AD, and they have found copper plates at Kanheri of the Traikutukas. Then you all had the Rashtrakuta rulers, followed by the Shilaharas, the Chalukyas. They were earlier the feudatories of the Chalukyas. Later on, they took over and became independent. And you all had Shilahara, followed by Bimbadeva, who established the city of Mumbai. And lastly, you all have the Portuguese and the English taking over. So this is a, you can say, rich history which Mumbai has. And here I would like to show you the edict of Ashoka found at Sopara. I thought you must see this is in the CSMVS or Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj Vastu Sangrahalaya, which gives us an evidence that this was a port in Brahmi. I just wanted to show you all Malabar Hill. Now, a question remains. Malabar Hill has got excellent amygdaloidal basalt. However, the location of Malabar Hill does not allow it to have caves, because there's no point in having a cave. However, Kulaba developed as a important port during the time of the Arabs. And if you know Kulaba, the word Kulaba is derived from Kulabe. That means the land jutting out. That is what the Arabs call it as. And so you'll start finding Arabic coins, dinars and all, near Kulaba. So you see, it was during only when ships, you can say, became very important. You will find that the people, they didn't use, the Arabs didn't use land routes. They decided to use the maritime routes. So now, what do you find over here? You'll find a union of different sects. We shall talk about this later on. But the Buddhists, you have the Hinayana, what you call as Theravadism, Mahanism and Vajrayanism. And these are the important sites, the Kondivit, the Kanheri. Kondivit means Mahakali, Magathane, the Sopara as a site, and Jivdani caves. There's a controversy that Jivdani at Virar were the earliest caves done in about 3rd century BC. They were just rooms today, it's converted into a temple. Then you have the Pashupata sect, which also has three, you can say, sites, Gharapuri, Jogeshwari and Mandapeshwar. At Parel, of course, on the hill, you have a beautiful image of Shiva, the only one of its kind in the whole country or in the world. I wanted to just show you all this Virgal or hero stones which are found at Exar. Today they have vanished and they're in somebody's possession. I'm trying my hardest to, you can say, get them back. But this shows there was a kind of a naval activity which took place in 10th century AD or so. These are hero stones. And there were martyrs who had died. They're very huge. You don't have such huge hero stones found. And I think as Mumbai cars over here, you should try and save them. And we should keep them in the CSMVA so that everyone can view them. This, I was a very sly person and I entered into the aqua club over there, which no longer exists. And I said I want to worship them and went and took photographs. So about 8.5 feet in height. So this was an ancient view of, you can say, Mumbai. I just wanted to show it to you all. How it looked like natives. You have the Kohlis here. And I want to show you all a cute little island over here, which not you and I, no one visits. This is on the western coast, which must have been previously visited. This is called as the Amwa Island. You can see a side view of a fort. Again, I requested the coalies to take me, fishermen to take me there. And there is a masjid on top over here, a small dargah. You have the watchtower of the Portuguese where they must have used it. There is the Amwa Devi's temple on this island. Nobody uses it. And there's also a small little chapel here. This is Elephanta. Now, I just wanted to show you all a glimpse of Elephanta. We will not concentrate ourselves on Elephanta because much is known. But if you'll want, it was known as Gharapuri. But the term is derived from Aghorapuri. That means the Aghora cult was practiced out over here. You have the Mahesha cult also, which existed there. You have, this is not Brahma, Vishnu and Mahesh. This is Aghora, Tatpurusha and Vamadeva. These are the three forms of Shiva as a creator, protector and destroyer. He's got a citron fruit in his hand here. Okay, and here I want to show you all that this cave is Sarvato, this thing, that means it's open from all the sides, four sides. Okay, it has got a Garbhagriha. This is the Shivlinga over here. And on one side, like in Indian culture, you should understand aesthetics also. You have the Dhammakaya form and the Rupakaya form. Rupakaya means image worship. Dhammakaya means symbolic worship. So the Shivlinga is a symbolic worship. And Rupakaya is supposed to be the human form. But when you look at three images over here, you have something quite different. It doesn't mean it is human. Okay, so it can be a mixture like Ganesha. So then how will you call, what term will you use for it? So this will be Adhyatmika Kaya form. That means you believe in something, the philosophical aspect of that particular, you can say, image. Now here I wanted to show you this Prasava Devata, which was discovered on the Elephanta Island. Now what is the significance? This is a small little, you can say, made of steatite or something of that kind. And this is an image, similar image was also found, I mean it is... In a sculpture is seen in Rameshwar cave at Ellora. Now what is the significance? The plan of this cave, including few sculptures, are similar to the Dhumar Lena, which is also at Ellora. So possible there was an exchange of artists from one place to the other. Guilds, what you call as. And to support this, unfortunately we don't have any inscriptions found over here. But you have Nigama. Nigama means a guild. Nigamas and all Shrenis mentioned in inscriptions at Kanheri. So we know that there must have been these kind of things happening. Yeah, I want to just show you all Nataraj over here, and these are the images. This is Aghora over here, and this is Vamadev here. Okay? I don't mind if you'll stop me in the middle because since we are talking about Elephanta, you can ask me questions before we can go ahead. So any questions, any doubts you'll have about it, I have no problems. Yes? See, this is a place for a person to live, stay. When you become a sannyasi, Leni comes from the word Lavanya, meaning beauty. This was called as mountain beauty. And so, many a times they never stayed in Sangharamas, what you call as Gautam Buddha didn't want them to stay. They had to be near the city, but at the same time away from it. And therefore, the best way was to stay in this kind of art. It requires a lot of effort. Of course, it was not the Buddhist monks who did it. There were artisans who did it. And they were given donations. I will come to that aspect in a couple of minutes. But so it was preferable. Now, you will see the earliest caves, especially in Orissa, in the Udaygiri and Khandagiri hills. You have the Jain caves, which are done by King Kharavela of Kalinga. Now, it was a very difficult task. You will find that some of the caves are done extremely well. But inside the caves, you can't even stand nor sleep properly. So a monk, a Jain monk was not even allowed to, you can say, stretch his legs or stand. So it was like self-mortification, as we can call it as. Okay, so this was a hard way of living, but Buddhists were much more, you can say, relaxed. They had beds, they had pillows, they had pillows also, and that small little case to keep their things also. Yes, sir.
Gharapuri is an island, right?
Yeah. No, it was like, I'll show you how it will have to go for like that. If I draw a map, say this is the Konkan region. If I say it's a Konkan region, to come to Sopara, you have to cross several islands. So the first island which you come across from the south will be Gharapuri. And from Gharapuri, you further proceed towards Thana, or what you call as Shri Sthanaka, or else take another, you can say, turn and cross towards Mahakali cave. So the crossing was near Ghatkopar. So the terms like Ghatkopar and all will tell you all that they signify certain meaning. For example, Vihar Lake. It comes from the word Vihar. Vihara is a place where monks live. And we'll come to Kanheri in 2 minutes' time. Okay? So Have you understood, young man, that why ladies were constructed? Okay, yeah. And that's why Buddha said that you have to, you can say, cut a scarf of a hill and reside over there and stay. You have to be tough and it should be bearable. I wanted to show you all the stupa at Sopara. This is the famous stupa. You can see its condition. This is after the rains when I visited it. And now they are repairing it. And Bhagwan Lal Indraji discovered, you can say, a few relics. They found a piece of the begging bowl over there. Just to tell you all a little bit about these stupas. These are brick stupas. Stupas can be of three kinds. I mean rather four kinds. Brick stupas can be of three kinds. What? Sharirika stupa, Paribhogika stupa, and Uddeshika stupa. Sharirika stupa, which contains the relics of Buddha's, any part of his, you can say bone or a tooth or whatever it may be, piece. That will be called as Sharirika stupa. Paribhogik stupa will contain any of the things which you use. Like for example, fragments of his bowl were found in this stupa. So it becomes a Paribhogika stupa. And Uddeshika stupa will be that stupa where Buddha went and preached. So it may not contain any of his relics in it. But it's a brick stupa. And you have what you call as votive stupas or Kamya stupas. So generally in caves, you'll see in Mumbai, these are votive stupas or Kamya stupas. They do not contain any relics of anybody in it. But we'll talk a little bit about it slightly later. So this is how the Sopara stupa looks like. This is a lake. If they excavate 100%, they'll find many things here. And of course, because the sea has, you can say, extended, you can see how it looks like. These are Jivdani caves on the hill. You cannot see the caves anymore. But they're just near to Sopara. So while you're crossing the station, you can see the Jivdani caves. And you can see this Daisar Creek here, how it is. And then you will be later on be able to understand why Magathane caves were excavated. So it is a very tough job, like to cross across this creek and reach Sopara. And there were Romans also who had trade because they found amphoras, pieces of, you can say, jars, Roman jars at Elephanta during that period. I'm just showing all these two lakes. From where the, you can say, monks would come all the way towards Kanheri. There is a route over here across Bihar and all, from where they used to climb towards Kanheri. And you can see the Ghatkopar hills. And the same route, and today also we are using that same route. So the link road, the Jogeshwari link road, was once upon a time a trade route. I just want to show you an aerial view of how it looks today. And here you have the Mahakali caves. So you can't even locate them. It's so difficult. And this is the Jogeshwari link road. I want to show you all a general view of Mahakali caves. This is a group of 17 caves. And on two sides, east and west facade. It belongs to about 1st century AD or so. There's an argument regarding it. We are interested in, you can say, the stupa over here. There is a circular chaitya gruha over here. Okay? Look at the room. It's a rectangular room and a round end. And there's a cute little inscription out here, which I'll speak about. Now, this cave, this chaitya hall, is similar to the Sudama cave, which was made by Ashoka in the 9th year of his reign. Identical. It's a rectangular room with a rare round end entrance inside. So you can see how this looks like. Sorry, it was very dark there. And you can see the Mauryan polish. The same polish you will see at Bhaja caves. So these were probably the same like artisans from the same guild, not the same artisan of course, but who have traveled all the way to excavate caves. Now this is the inscription, the only inscription at Mahakali cave, which says, Gautamesa Gotenasa Brahmanasasa Pitukasasa Bhatukasa Imayo Viharo Patikaya Vatavasaya Deya Dhammam. Let me tell you all, this is a very, very important inscription, which is just, you can say, not looked at. Now this indicates that a Brahmin from the Gautama Gotra, along with his father and his, you can say, brothers, has excavated this cave, this Viharo, for the benefit of the travelers from the protection of wind and rain. Viharo Patikaya Vatavasaya Deya Dhammam, merit as a religious merit. This indicates there was a mobility during that period. Even Brahmins could do this act of donation. You need not become a Buddhist here. There is this argument over here. So such a kind of flexibility existed. And this inscription indicates the use of caves. This was meant for travelers. Okay? This is in Brahmi. Let me tell you all over here, how can you divide cave architecture into? Cave architecture can be divided into Chaityas and Viharas. Vihara is a place where you reside, and Chaitya Chitta means mind. That is the Buddha, the ultimate. That's the way. And Gruha means where the mind resides. So you have the Chaitya Gruha. Vihara can be further divided into Matappas. Matappas are halls of two kinds. Bhojana Matappa, Uposatha Matappa. Bhojana means for eating. The monks would beg and come back up, you can say, to the cave, share the food with each other. That was called as Bhojana Matappa. And in the rains, they were allowed to cook. Uposatha Matappa is where they had the confession ceremony on the 15th day of the month. And it could be possible they could use the Matappa for both the occasions. Then you all have over here podis or water cisterns. Now the system of rainwater harvesting can be understood through these caves here. So you have Panya Podi and you have Snana Podi. Panya Podi means that water which is used for drinking purpose. Snana means that podi which is used for bathing purpose. And they also had Jantagar or toilets as well. Then they had also Asana Pedikas or benches for you to enjoy yourself and see the view. So that at Kanheri, for example, you have a beautiful cave number 65 where you can see the view of the, you can say, sea. And it is river Sagar Darshan. So something very beautiful and exciting. Then you have kodis or recesses to keep something. We really don't know what it must be used for. Now, this is the Kamya Stupa which was found at Mahakali, which is how it looked like. Now, you can see over here that there is Mahakal. This is a Vajrayana Stupa. He is supposed to be a deity called as Mahakal. Now, it has got something very interesting. Those who know grammar, you have haplology. Mahakal's consort is Mahakali. So, Mahakal Adhik Mahakali is equal to Mahakali. There is no image of any goddess at Mahakali. The same can be attributed to Jogeshwari also. Jogeshwar, Yogeshwar, his consort is Yogeshwari or Jogeshwari. And that is why the Jogeshwari caves are known as Jogeshwari. To be really honest with you all, that was supposed to be a Shivlinga and it is today worshipped as a Jogeshwari goddess. Okay, so this is the stupa here at Mahakali. This is how it looks today and is worshipped as Mahakali in a temple down below. Okay, if you all get a chance, you can see it in one of the slums. And the same kind of stupa was found at Dadar. This is worshipped as a Shivlinga. Near Shivaji Park, we found it. And you will see it has also got Mahakal. So this shows the existence of Vajrayana cult, which believes in Tantrism in 6th century AD in Mumbai city. And the same kind of stupa, like this Kamya stupa, was found at Panhale Kaji near Dapoli. Such stupas are also found if you go to see near the Tata Electrical, this thing at Kandivali also you have such kind of stupas, which will indicate Vajrayana cult. And these are the Mahakali caves. Now because of the rock, they could not do much carving here. This is not a good basalt. I just wanted to show you all slums over here. They have been removed recently. And this is a mark of, you can say, Hinayana Buddhism. This is a Kamya stupa, just to mark that this is the existence of a cave. And again, since they believed in Dhammakaya form, the Theravadins or Hinayanas, they never had any image of Buddha done at Mahakali. However, after their decline in the Chaitya Hall, you will find these images of Avalokiteshvara standing here. And you will see, you can say, Buddha seated. Now, these are supposed to be the Manushi Buddhas, the seven Buddhas, what you call as prior to, you can say, this is the Maitreya Buddha who is yet to come. And you have these others who belong to this previous, you can say. And before he became a Buddha, he has to, you can say, undergo several reincarnations. And then only achieves, you can say, the ultimate. So you have the Manushi Buddhas here. Now, if you look at this image is similar to the fun of Lakulisha at Elephanta. You will see that Shiva is shown seated as the founder of the Pashupada sect in the same manner, flanked by Nanda and Upananda on both the sides. So you see, the Brahmanical caves have borrowed many ideas from the Buddhist caves. So this is the only, you can say, section which has got images at Mahakali. Now this was a tank which was excavated on top. Of course, there are water cisterns also over there. And you can see the hillock over here. Now, here while walking one day, I discovered another cave. You can see it. And so they dropped me from top down. I asked some of the helpers to help me. I had a very bad time at that time because it was a session of all plants which itched me throughout. And I thanked my husband for removing me from there. So you can see that it is this on top is Kamal Amroha's property. According to the act, you cannot have any excavations done in the 300 meter periphery, but yet they're doing it. The caves are inside over here on top, and they're quarrying over here. This is the top of that thing and how they're removing everything from here, and these are the caves. Well, you can't say whether they're Buddhist or Shaivite. I cannot prove anything. So since I was behind them, I could take a few photographs. And these are some of the people at Mahakali. We come to the next phase here, and that is Kanheri, also known as Krishnagiri. And these are, you can say, existing from about 1st century BC. Now you have a quotation by a traveler in 1539 by Don Juan de Castro, where he said this was a palace like buildings existed. So this was the biggest Western, you can say, educational university in India. The only rock cut university in the western part of India. So you had Vallabhi in Gujarat, and in Maharashtra you had Kanheri, as you all can see. And there were other visitors also who came here, Portuguese. Gemelli Carreri was an Italian traveler who visited here. And of course you had British, because they had cave number 11, they have put in Roman initials there. Okay, so this is situated about 8 kilometers from Borivali station. And these 120 caves are located on three different hills, northern, southern and eastern. And again, you have three phases of art here: the Satavahana, the Traikutakas and the Rashtrakutas. 1st century AD onwards till 5th and 6th century the Traikutakas, and after which you all have the Rashtrakutas. I just want to show you, this is the first cave in Kanheri, but actually this is the last cave in Kanheri. This was done during the Shilara period. It starts with this cave. So you can understand cave architecture. Once you all can come with me, then I can talk more about these things. Otherwise, it will be too boring if you see the technical aspect of it. I want to show you all this, which is in cave number 3. These are Dampatis or donor couples. Many of them call them as amorous or Mithuna couples. They are not. This shows that you can say the equality which existed during the Satavahana period. If you all remember, it was a matriarchal, matrilineal rule. And so you'll find women shown with the merchant class, like they're standing side by side of each other. And when you look at the earrings, some of the earrings are very similar to the earrings found on sculptures at Ter. Ter or Tagar near Solapur was an important commercial center. And here you'll have, see, in the Satavahana phase, you have both Dhammakaya and the Rupakaya. So inside, when you have the Dhammakaya, outside you'll find the Rupakaya form coming in. So you have the images of Buddha made in that period. Now many, there's a controversy that this could be a, you can say, Gupta style, but this is not actually a Gupta style. But some feel that this was an intrusive image which has come in over there. And you'll see the stupa over here. Now you'll find remnants of wood also over there, because there were carpenters who had turned into masons. And you will see that many of these, you can say, this is one of the biggest Chaitya halls, not the biggest, the Karla Chaitya hall is the biggest. But many of them did not even receive donations. So you'll find that these sculptures over here have not been, I mean, they have not, you can say, had any donor couples out here on top. I just want to show you that important cave over here, which can have Sagar Darshan. And they had actually like a roof on top to allow the flow, I mean, of water. I wanted to show you all this cave. This is cave number 11, the Darbar Hall. And this could have been a Bhojan Matappa for the monks to sit. Perhaps they would be meditating also on it. They might be having some kind of a pravachan, because if you look at monasteries in northeast, you will find that they all sat, and generally they used to read the scriptures on this. So probably identical cave was also found, the same one here at Ellora. Maharwada cave number 5. So you can see there is some kind of a similarity, and this was done by the Rashtrakuta. So there's a controversy, but they found two inscriptions outside this cave. So probably it was done by the Rashtrakutas. Something very interesting over here, that there were murals also. And cave number 34, this is actually in cave number 90. You will see this design over here, Buddha stelae. You'll find few this thing. But here you have cave number 34, and you will see how paintings were done. In what manner? So these are the only paintings which can be seen at Kanheri with proper symmetrical lines. And he is seen in Bhumi Sparsha Mudra. These were never completed on top of a roof in cave number 34. I come to a different aspect here, and that is Vajrayanism. Now this is supposed to be the 11-headed Avalokiteshvara, the only one of its kind in the whole country. He is worshipped in China as Kuan Yin. I don't know whether you ever heard about Kuan Yin. And you will find that this concept is mentioned by Yashogupta in Ekadasha Shirsha, and that is of 5th century AD. So probably this image was done during the Traikutaka period. And next to him you will see an image of Buddha seated, and he's actually got a fruit, like a bowl in his hand, and he is supposed to be Baishacha Guru. Baishacha Guru means medicinal Buddha, very much popular in Tibet. This is the only image of its kind which you all will see over here.
Which is this cave?
This is supposed to be cave number 41. Yeah, Vidyadhara. And Baishacha Guru means you can pray for medicine. I don't mind telling you a small little cute incident over here. That one day I had a lecture at Kanheri, and just one day before that I fell down from, you can say, one story down, and I broke my leg. And I was in tears because it was supposed to be a national lecture. And I didn't know what to do. I said, now it will be in bandage and I missed my beautiful lecture. Across, I stayed at Malad, so across I could see the hills. And suddenly I thought of Baishacha Guru. So I said, okay, I'm praying to you now. Please help me. I want to reach. And if I reach over, I'll bow down before you in front of everyone. And I'll keep bowing whenever I reach. And of course, nothing happened, but... this is how you can say, since I teach ancient Indian culture, I took my leg and put it in the, you can say, salt water, and I switched on Om Mani Padme Hum because I love that tune. And next day my foot was like swollen very bad. I hopped in a rick and I reached over there. I said, now what? They saw my leg, but I didn't say anything. I said, now Baishacha Guru, better help me. In English only I said it. And I found, you can say, a branch of a tree. I picked up that branch. Believe it or not, but I climbed all the entire three hills first before everybody could, and they just looked at me, how in the world are you walking? I said, don't ask me that. I reached there, I bowed down before him, I said, thank you. I told him the incident, and when I reached down, the branch broke into two, of course, and I went back to the doctor, but I had no fracture, thanks. But anyway, now to believe or not to believe is another question mark, but this is supposed to be the only medicinal Buddha which we have in India over here. So if you'll get a chance, you all can go over here and see. Yeah, break your leg or any illness, you can go and pray to the medicinal Buddha over here. Okay, so many feel that this could be also, you can say, a conversion of the violent god of the Vedic age, the 8th Rudra, like the Rudras over here, Ekadasha Rudra from Brahmanism. So there are controversies regarding this this image over here, but there's a question mark. Now he's mentioned in Nagarjuna Konda over here, and also in 5th century AD by the Huna king Toramana. So you will find that probably from Nagarjuna Konda in Andhra Pradesh, this cult must have gone towards Punjab in western Pakistan. Question marks, we really can't say anything much about this. But this is the only image of its kind here. I wanted to show you all the rainwater harvesting system. And you have the queens donating caves here. I mean, water cisterns here. And this is, you can say, purifying water. This is an image which you will see over here. Just near cave number 11, you will see this. The procedure of cleaning, purifying water. This is a tank on top. And this is an inscription of a Sethi Punaka from Sopara who has made a dam to stop the water from falling from. So there are two junctions. He has built a brick dam to protect this and use this water during the other season. So this is the brick walls which he had built, and that inscription which you all can see. So something very unique which they have done. Perhaps if we can do something, we can use this water which goes waste. Now, something very interesting about Kanheri itself is supposed to be this Nirvana Vitti, or the only smashan which I have seen of the Buddhists of 1st century AD. This is a cemetery with brick stupas. So you can understand these are Sharirik stupas, which you will see over here. There are over 50 stupas out here and with inscriptions on them. Okay, this is a very interesting place. You can go and meditate also over here. You can't go in the rains. You have to go now only or after October, November, because it's on the southern this thing, hill. And these are the inscriptions. This one which you all see over here is in Kharoshti, and that one over there is by a Japanese. So you can see visitors who visited this place. They have carved over here. This is cave number 19. Yeah. Japanese, there's a question mark, maybe 12th century AD. Yeah. Well, this is 6th. And now, there's a whole big now issue about it, that I visited this so-and-so place over here. I have the inscriptions with you. If you want, I can show it to you all. But I'm not getting into that. It's for, you can say, Deya Dhamma, I give so-and-so money for so-and-so purpose. And I visited this place. Now, for example, this is cave number 21 at Kanheri. Very insignificant. This was built during the time of Yajnashri Shatakarani. But what is so unique about this cave is that there's an inscription in this cave which mentions that a land at Mangalasthanaka or Maggasthanaka should be given for, and say the income from it, the interest which is, you can say, derived from it, has to be given for, you can say, the monks for their robes. Okay? And this Magathane is none other than Magathane caves. That's why this is very, it's exactly opposite cave number 11. And that's how we come to the Magathane caves. Yeah? Yeah. You have to come with me to see it. I'll take you there and then we'll be able to, you can say, enjoy. Believe it or not, you can really sleep peacefully in this place. And it's air conditioned for 24 hours, 365 days of the year. And they have, to really be understand, if you all want to know, the Hinayana caves had beds. The earliest Hinayana caves even have pillows. We don't have pillows here. But you have beds there. So you can identify which is an early cell and a later cell. Each cell even had doors, proper wooden doors to save them from animals. And some of them even had latticed windows. Such latticed windows can be seen even at Jogeshwari. And it is very cool inside. You can sit and meditate. If you ever get a chance to come with me, I'll take you to Bedsa Caves. They're the most beautiful caves which I have in Pitalkhora, where you can really relax, meditate, and you can get a very good energy over here. And in spite of it being a hot season, you can really feel peaceful and relaxed over here. Now, these are located at Dattapada Road at, on, you can say, the Mumbai, Bombay Western Express Highway. You can see this cave over here. You'll see a Gayatri Mandir built on top in 1991, permission given by a charity commissioner. Now you can see these Magathane caves. It comes from the word Magga. Magga means a road, Thane means a halt. You see what has happened at Kanheri was, when you have 125 caves and with different sects, you had over here Mahasangikas, you all had Aparaselias, you all had Chetikas, you all had Bhadrayaniyas, all of them living happily, Chetikas living happily ever after. It became a confusion for a monk, a layman to come there. And all he wanted was just to halt, but to go in the deep jungle over there was very difficult. And therefore they decided to, you can say, excavate caves in that very own region of theirs for the travelers who would stop for a moment and go ahead. So these were built by the Vajrayanists out there. And you will find lots of podis, a tank also out here inside the cell and also outside. This is the main road of the Dattapada opposite Tata Steel. You can't even locate the caves over here. You can see the whole ground. Now where this girl is walking was supposed to be a tank. And you can see how they have, you can say, occupied this place. And they made it into a small little hut. This is how it looked like in the, you can say, early 40s. This is how it looks like before the rains and during the rains. And here you can see in the background those caves. Let's enter those caves now. And there was supposed to be the gazetteer mentions this thing, stupas over there, the Kamya stupas which have vanished and has been taken over by this lady who lives on top, who has established a Gayatri Mandir. There is no such, you can say, goddess as Gayatri. She has made, you can say, an image of her samadhi of her two parents there. Permission given by the charity commissioner. Okay, so here you have the image of Buddha which has been eroded, smeared and has been worshipped as a Shakti. Here you can see it. And because there is a car, you can see the seven Manushi Buddhas and there's a tank here. The small image all have been covered. This is how it looked like. Now because there is a carving up on the lintel, which is seen, indicates it belongs to perhaps the Rashtrakuta phase. This is how it looks today. It's a very beautiful Makara Torana which you all will see. And that stupa which is painted. Here you can see Nagas on it. And this is how it looked like with the Vidyadharas and Nagas. And it's completely spoiled. You don't have any Makara Torana like this anywhere here. This is 7th, 8th century AD. They put, and you can see this lotus-like, you can say, designs, petal on the lintel. And this is a tank inside the house. There's a refrigerator also over there. And they cook, there are fish also inside. Fresh water. Now this is a, you can say, cave, which is on the first floor. What we were at the zero level. So people have occupied these caves also. They have made, you can say, rooms outside. Inside you can see such kind of remnants. This is all on the first floor. And this was the encroachment of the Gayatri temple. And this is Samadhi of her parents. Now what happened was, you can see this, these are caves which are inside over there, further. They have occupied the land out there. And from this building, another builder who came, the Ekta builder, he also started excavating. And I went on the 7th floor in the Someshwara building. And while they were excavating rapidly, I discovered this by the camera. There was a, you can say, site here. As soon as I reported it, he came and he destroyed the whole thing. And now there's a building over here. Unfortunately, I had no Mumbai cars to support me. Now this is the Heaven Industries, which is just near it. And there are references to a tank here, which has been, you can say, covered up. And which has been now used for wedding purposes. These are wells in the vicinity and these are relating to Shilahara phase of 10th century AD. Proper wells, you can see the way they have done it. Perhaps if they, you can say, they can remove the scarcity of water if they clean it and develop it. Now, why was Magathane very important? And I decided to walk right from Magathane caves. I said, wherever the road leads me to. And I found it was very easy. It led me right near the Charkop Creek. I walked. And I reached over here. This was originally a kind of a harbor. And it's no longer a harbor. It's dried up. And this was the old, you can say, river. The Poisar River, what you call as, which has become into a canal. And you can see this is the Gorai, this thing. You can see they were building, making the pagoda. And right in the, here, you will see that this is where that Charkop Creek comes. So it was much easier for the monk, or a traveler, to go from here, sail to Sopara, then come all the way back to Gorai, and then go ahead. So they preferred to use Magathane as a, you can say, place to move in 6th, 7th century AD. This is from Gorai, which is taken. Now this is the overall view. Satellite view of Magathane. You can't even notice it. It lies over here. So this is the Poisar River, which they generally used. We go to the next caves, the Brahmanical caves and Mandapeshwar. Just as Buddhism declined, you had the Brahmanical caves taking over, and you have Mandapeshwar here, known as Mont Pezil, which was actually destroyed by the Portuguese. You have beautiful church ruins on top. It's a simple cave that way. There are three, four, you can say, small caves. But what is more striking over here is this is the beginning of Brahmanical cave temples. And you have a beautiful image of Nataraj, which you will see here. Much better than even Elephanta. And you can see the ruins of this cave. They are doing conservation work over here. I wanted to show you all Jogeshwari caves. And you will see that once upon a time, you all had all of them occupying this area. And this is actually the entrance from the west, but the actual entrance is from the east. The concept is that you enter into the womb of a mother, Garbhagruha. And so the tube over there is a very long one to reach the womb of a mother. So it's a long trail down, about you can say 120 steps like almost. You have to go deep inside and you realize the truth. The truth is that it is because the union of Purusha and Prakriti, the world is created. And that is, once you receive that enlightenment, you can easily come outside on the western side. And you will see this T concept over here. You will see the Nataraja over here. This is on the eastern side. And you will see Dampati shown over here, this concept out here. Again, they had done methods of rainwater harvesting. You can see, which has all been covered up. And this is that route to go down towards the Garbhagruha. Yeah?
The previous one you showed just before this was in Borivali, right?
Which one? The Mandapeshwar? Yeah. Yeah.
Now, there is some apparently controversy. We call them Brahmanical.
They are Brahmanical only.
Yeah, but some Buddhists are saying that they have.
See, this is a map. I spoke with those Buddhists.
You know that there is a...
Yeah, I know that. They came to me, I showed it to them, I logically explained to them. I said, every cave cannot be a Buddhist cave. You have to understand this concept. They spoke with me, they realized it. But then there are a few fanatics, you can't help it. Okay. So you can see the beautiful art, you can see Lakulisha seated over here, see the intricate car, and you can see the development of temple architecture shown at the entrance. This is the Kalyana Sundar Murti, look at the small image over here. And you have the Dwarapala and a small little Gana. So this is again to the entrance of this cell, to the main hall. I have come to Parel Shiva. I don't think so you have ever seen such a kind of image in the city of Mumbai. There, it is called generally as Baradev, but these are the Ganas which are there for, while these are the eight forms. And each form has got a meaning behind them. And each of the name, it actually stands for the, you can say, different elements which are like air, water, sun, moon, ether, all fire, all this is what it stands for. So what exactly you can say is, who are they? You have Bhava over here, you have Ishwara over there, you have Ugra down here, you have Mahadev, you have Pashupati, you have Ishan over there, and Shiva and Bhima. So these are all the forms of Shiva which have been mentioned. And these are, there are 10 hands. So actually it's Ashtatanu, but they are not Ashtamukha, like you saw the 11-headed Avalokiteshvara. So each one of them has a separate identity of their own. Parel was supposed to be a kind of a factory where they created images. What I feel personally is that they wanted to make a much better image than Mahesh Murthy. But after the excavation of Mahesh Murthy, they could not make a bigger image. There was no hillock to make one. And therefore they abandoned. This is incomplete at the corners over here. And so they left this image over here. And each of them has a separate identity with separate things in their hands. For example, you have Kevuras, you have Akshay Mala in the hand, and you can just go on. One has got a Shara on the right side, you have got a Shara, that's an arrow. On the other side, he's got a Dhanu in his hand. So it just goes on, and you can easily identify each one of them. This is 7th, 8th century AD. Parel Shiva, as it is called as Baradev. Of course, along with it, I also found Virgals or hero stones there. And I found a lion and a lioness and a monkey removing a lice of another monkey, like you see in Mahabalipuram. Yeah. Mahesh Murthy. That is Skanda for this thing. Yeah, Soma Skanda. That was also found over here. I cannot show you it without permission. So there is Soma Skanda and also an image of Parvati. Correct. Pardon?
Where do we find this?
If you go to Hafkin Institute, from Hafkin Institute at the corner, you take a left turn and then straight climb up the hillock and ask for Baradev and they will show it to you. So I just wanted to show you all the records of wells in Mumbai, how many we have, and we are just scribbling over scarcity of water. But what has happened to us when we have so much of rainwater harvesting and bathrooms and snanakotis and jantagars and we don't make use of all these things? So basically our heritage, you can say, is made of tangible and intangible heritage and natural heritage. Are we really making use of this heritage which Mumbai possesses? We have such a lot of it over here. And the causes of decay are natural causes. Of course, you can't help about the rocket. Man-made causes are what are more important, and the causes of deterioration are because of lack of awareness here. Of course, natural causes are there, climate and all. You will find caves being leaking and all. Leakages found, insects, bacteria, bats, all these things are there. But humans are the main cause. Vandalism, graffiti on the walls, quarrying. Quarrying has destroyed one important cave site in Mumbai, known as Padan Hills. Padan Hills, situated at Kandivali, had caves with inscriptions. Bhagwan Lal Indrajit had written about them, but unfortunately we destroyed quarry. Today you have a fantastic building on top of it, none other than Times of India. Okay, these caves we found just last week at Majas, at because some, you can say, residents over here spoke about it. They had taken a photograph of this, and the MK uses sector 60 across Jogeshwari, and the caves are situated actually at the entrance of the building. They have been covered up very slyly by the builder. So unfortunately, because they fall 300 meters beyond the periphery of Jogeshwari caves, ASI said we can't do anything about it. So you can see where the caves are located. The entrance of the cave is right below here. And it's a very huge cave, as big as Jogeshwari. So it's covered up by the builder. This territory belongs to the builder, MK, and this belongs to the BMC. And there have been people, I have some of them here sitting here, who have witnessed and who have seen this cave, but overnight, within a week's time, this fellow covered, the builder covered the whole thing up. And you can see people happily playing cricket here. And you can see we are running for water. And this is, you can say, they are supplying this water to different parts of Mumbai. You can see the condition of the water here. You can see these are wells in Malad. And how here you can see, these are all near cave sites. We are using all these things over here, the roots. And he's enjoying and sleep in Mahakali cave here. And so I ask you all, save your heritage before it falls. Thank you.